celebrated Mega 2 Days Management Event of the Year. We all are even more excited this year as we would be starting the celebration of IMA's 50th year. Kirloskar, to accept our request to be our guest and speaker for the curtain raiser of IMA's 22nd International Management Conclave 2013. May I now request for a floral welcome to our chief guest, Mr. Sanjay Kirloskar.
Mr. Kirloskar has promoted conservation of energy in the Kirloskar Group to promote green industrialization since 1989. He heads CII's ASEAN Committee. We heartily welcome Mr. Sanjay Kirloskar. A big hand for him, ladies and gentlemen.
Share your views with us.
First of all, thank you very much for inviting me to address you this evening. I'm really grateful for all of you for being present here today, and I hope that what I have to say you find that useful and worthwhile. Like the Indore Management Association, Kirloskar Brothers has also been in Marwar region for 50 years. In fact, we celebrate 50 years of our inauguration of Pandevas factory. And I would really like to thank all of you, and I am sure that over this period of my 60 years, the Indore Management Association and its offices have helped us in our growth. And with your good wishes and blessings, I'm sure that just like our Kirloskarwadi factory did, our Devas factory will also complete a century in 54 years. The topic that I wanted to speak about, that I guess is written over here, innovation, creativity, and ethics in the corporate world. I've changed it a little bit in the introduction, they talked about sustainability. I decided that I would add sustainability because innovation and creativity sort of hand in hand. And I would also like to say that ethics is something that's going to play an increasingly important part in corporate culture. And that's why I'd like to speak about that as well. To begin with, the global economy is passing through turmoil. Over the last 12 years, the major economies have been in a recession-like syndrome for approximately 8 years. The United States risks another recession. After pulling out of the previous one, you hear about the fiscal cliff talks. I guess it seems like just because of politics, these discussions are being held hostage. 5 Eurozone countries, Greece, Spain, Italy, Portugal, and Cyprus are at the center of Europe's debt crisis. Under these circumstances, the spotlight has naturally shifted to what are known as the BRIC economies, as Brazil, Russia, India, and China. Together, we occupy about 25% of the world's area and are home to 40% of the world's population. It is well accepted that India is becoming an engine that will drive global growth. Since 1991, our economy is gradually marching towards economic liberalization. This transition has made India an attractive destination for foreign investment. The Indian economy has witnessed, after the Hindu rate of growth of approximately 2% that we had for most of the time after independence, unprecedented growth driven by booming services and industry sector in the last 6 to 7 years. Brand India is now very accepted and received globally. This development has propelled India into the league of the top 15 countries in the world in terms of GDP. Factors such as an increasing young working age population, better education facilities, and concomitant rise in income levels, relatively high savings rate, and urbanization are working in our favor. India is fast becoming the knowledge capital of the world as well, with its talented resources working across the globe. In years to come, we will probably see a slowing west and a speeding east, with India taking the lead. This situation is not quite unlike what it was 300 years ago, when India and China accounted for almost 35% of global GDP. This is why people from the west first came to India to make their fortunes. The profound changes in the current decade presents India and the Indian business community with challenges and opportunities. Economic growth during the decade shall bring with it challenges in terms of meeting rising energy needs and increased degradation of natural resources. At the same time, a young India has ever-growing aspirations for a better quality of life and the ability to create wealth. For all that to happen, however, we need to understand that a lot is dependent on how our generation sets the tone for growth and how we build our country for the future. Let us remember that at the time when the Europeans first came to India, we were amongst the wealthiest and most powerful nations. If that story of losing our political independence is not to be repeated by losing our economic independence this time, we have to commit to educate all our people, build strong national institutions, and work towards creating an equitable society. We will have to encourage creativity and innovation to ensure that we go ahead. I would also suggest that we would have to support our local and Indian-owned businesses to grow globally. This is what every country that went ahead economically has done. If we want a rich India, we have to ensure that our fellow Indians become rich with us. It has been my experience that if one buys a system from any Western country or from Japan, one will see how they promote other products from their own countries to put together their product offering. This could be because companies have grown together or have a strategic partnership, or it is convenient to work in that way. Why did the British take over our country politically? It's because we were not united. Nowadays, companies have a larger sales turnover than GDP of certain countries. So is the situation comparable when Indian companies prefer to buy from foreign-owned companies or foreign companies when goods of similar quality or maybe lower price are available from Indian-owned ones? I run a young 92-year-old company that exports its products to over 80 countries around the globe, from New Zealand in the east to the United States in the west. Whether it's a Bechtel or a Siemens, or a Japan gas company or a Thailand, all are our repeat customers. What I find is these companies look at a company's capability and culture, then whether it has a proven track record for a certain product. To me, it's laughable when a Navratna rejects us for not having made a product of a size in between sizes that we have already made before and are working well. And this when Bechtel and Siemens have placed orders on us for products that we have never made before. My point is that we need to trust our fellow citizens, we need to have more belief in ourselves, and we need the self-respect not to ask a fellow citizen to get a certificate from a foreigner. You won't see the Chinese behaving this way. They create a way for their companies to compete and place obstacles for foreigners. Orders to foreign companies are given only if they commit to bring the latest technology to China. The latest is that General Electric will be making jet engines for airplanes in China. It isn't going to be long when we see a Chinese company compete with China, like there are Chinese aircraft manufacturers now intending to compete with Boeing. They're very clear that they want their country at the top, and the way they're going, it looks very possible. And this is where we need to look at ourselves to decide that if we want to go to the top, what is it that is going to take us to the top, and what do we need to do, and what does each one of us need to do? When my grandfather was a young man in the 1930s, he procured an order from the United Provinces, now Uttar Pradesh, of a value twice the company's sales turnover for a product it had never made before. I sometimes wonder whether this happened because there was an Englishman at the other side of the table. Because I find it very difficult sometimes when there's an Indian at the other side of the table. So my point is that there are certain things we need to change in our business culture. That being said, I'll move to the topics for the day. Because they are very important issues as we go forward. These are sustainability, innovation and ethics. You know, as we develop, we need to keep in mind that we do not develop as wastefully as the West did. Because it is commonly said that we have borrowed our planet from future generations. But how often do we think of this in the race for wealth creation and development? There's a huge concentration towards development and growth. However, sometimes I feel that sustainable development, with its focus on improving the quality of lives without compromising on ecological balance of our earth, is missing. We need to guarantee a livable habitat for our children and our grandchildren, and that's something that we cannot forget. Sustainability of our planet is today compromised by our activities. Depletion of mineral and fossil fuel reserves, water scarcity, depletion of vegetation, industrial waste are some of the challenges which we are facing today. Greenhouse gas emissions and reduction of forest cover are causing widely observed phenomena of global warming. This situation adversely impacts the hydrological cycle, increasing the frequency of floods and droughts. Governments across the world have pledged to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. This framework was outlined in the Kyoto Protocol in 1997. A major feature of the Kyoto Protocol is that it sets binding targets for 37 industrialized countries and the European community for reducing greenhouse gas emissions. India has also pledged to reduce the emissions intensity of our GDP by 20-25% by the year 2020 on 2005 levels. And over here, emissions from the agricultural sector are not included. India's 12th five-year plan, that's from 2012 to 2017, has a low carbon growth strategy as one of its key pillars. Well, there are many aspects to sustainability. As a person from a pump manufacturing company, I will stick to the subject that I know best, which is water. This is not to say that the others are not as important, but I know more about this topic. And here, experts say that the new oil is water. On a global scale, we're already seeing how this affects relationships between countries as well as states in our own union. It is said that President Sadat of Egypt signed a peace treaty with Israel in 1979 in order to get a better grip on the threat from the south. Egypt, with its growing population, needs great access to the Nile waters, which the Sudan and Ethiopia also claim. In recent times, the Chinese are building large dams in China on the Mekong, along with Laos and Cambodia. And this is putting strains on the ASEAN community. New dams built by Turkey have Syria and Iraq worried. The wall that's been built by Israel is more about keeping control of the water resources than the Palestinians out of Israel. Global warming, climate change, increasing population, urbanization and industrialization increase strain on water bodies. India has 16% of the world's production, but only 4% of its freshwater resources. By the year 2025, per capita per annum water availability in India is projected to be less than 500 cubic meters, implying that if we do not act now, India will be amongst those countries worst hit by water scarcity. India's infrastructure for water storage and distribution is under severe strain, coupled with intermittent monsoon failures. Our country has the capacity to store 250 billion cubic meters of water and adds new capacity of 6 to 7 billion cubic meters per year. But this is not adequate to tap annual rainfall of over 4,000 billion cubic meters. The situation has adversely impacted crops and agricultural operations. We therefore have to understand that water is part of a larger ecological system. Realizing the importance and scarcity of fresh water, it needs to be treated as an essential and most precious natural resource for sustaining all life forms. Our Earth is a finite, delicately interconnected and complex natural system. Therefore, the daunting task before us is to adapt to a fine-tuned Earth so as to achieve civilized systems. this task is going to be even tougher because the world population in the last 50 years has crossed 7 billion. And we are the second most populous country with over 1.22 billion people. In the coming years, we need to judiciously utilize all our natural resources. We need to make all our efforts for conservation and replenishment. We have to measure the amount of resources we use and set stiff targets to reduce their usage. Or else the very resources we all need to run our businesses may deplete. We're staring at a nightmare situation where we may starve for resources. The very social fabric of our society depends on natural resources, and the businesses, as we know them, may not exist. The resource scarcity may cause mass uprisings and wars and throw us back to the Stone Age. We've seen what happens between Karnataka and Tamil Nadu with their water issues all the time. We cannot forget that we are answerable to our future generations. And as a company, you know, we believe that we each have to do our bit. And we've gone to the extent of building a platinum-rated green corporate office building. And guess what we've learned by building something that's supposedly more expensive? It makes economic sense to invest that extra bit. Because it pays off very quickly and then helps you be competitive by lowering the running costs that you pay every minute of the day. So I would urge all of you to invest in green technologies. It is going to cost a little more. You are going to see the benefits very quickly. As far as innovation is concerned, it will be one of the most critical parameters for sustainability and growth. Innovation is required to set right the damage that's been done by us. It is time we address the sustainability challenge as the next big opportunity for business. The next wave of innovation will be in developing energy-efficient products, recyclable and environmentally friendly products, products which reduce global warming and improve air quality. The world over, businesses are taking steps in this direction, and it is the right time for us in India to do so too. With sustainability-related policies being enforced in several markets, our products may also find that they are blocked out of such markets. Energy-efficient clean technologies are gaining importance, which can affect our business models. So I don't think that we have any option but to innovate and to adapt. Considering the importance of sustainability, the purpose of any business is no more restricted to profit maximization. Businesses need to accord weightage to our neighborhoods and environment stakeholders. Industries are required to qualify on the impact they create on the environment and the subsequent mitigation initiatives that they undertake. In our company, our commitment towards innovation has helped us secure more than 17 patents in the last few years, some Indian and some US. One notable patent is the siphon creation and breaking arrangement that we've made for our concrete volume and vertical turbine pumps at the Sardar Sarovar Narmada Nigam Saurashtra branch canal pumping project. We're responsible from concept to commissioning of this system. The system lifts 630,000 liters of water per second from the canal to provide irrigation and drinking water to 132 drought affected towns in Gujarat. The entire system was made energy efficient, saving 12 crores of rupees per annum on energy consumption. We're also promoting the concept of lowest life cycle cost pumps based on the total cost of ownership. Trouble-free service for a long period, minimum downtime, sustainable energy efficiency are the hallmarks of our LNC pumps. Other innovative products include tamper-proof kinetic air valves. Which prevent water losses due to water valve tampering, pump as a turbine, which harnesses excess electricity generation, and solar pumps running on solar energy. We offer energy audit services to our customers to assess energy requirements of their old installations and recommend solutions to reduce energy requirements. And some of these have been done right here in Indore and Devas. These products and services reduce the carbon footprint and judiciously utilize our natural resources. more than an advertising plug for my company, I just thought I have to tell you that one has to practice what one teaches. So we are doing some of these things. Sustainability related challenges are not the only reason to innovate. Despite low emissions on a per capita basis, India is at the center of attention because of our huge population. With FDI friendly policies coming into effect, will we face increasing competition from global companies? How will we compete without differentiating continuously? Just before I came down here, I met some of your senior executives, and we were talking about how India is known for frugal engineering. I think that's one of the greatest strengths that we have. The innovation engine of the company cannot rest anymore. With information technology, knowledge has become a commodity, and information travels at the speed of light. Similarly, educational achievements in developing countries and aging population in Western countries are changing the face of science and technology. The innovation engine needs to run and run fast. Innovation need not only be product-centric. Innovation can also be related to business models, business processes, or market segmentation. In business and economics, innovation is a catalyst for growth. For innovation to flourish, there is a need to change the culture and mindset of our people. We need to invest in people and instill the innovation DNA amongst the young. Every company could have an innovation process and innovation fund, where teams are encouraged to experiment, but are free to fail, because there's a lot of learning from failure. In our company, we've institutionalized an innovation-linked high-mission process, which encourages youngsters to meet customers to learn from them and helps us focus on innovation. The process ensures that we bring out innovative and customer-centric products to the market, and the process also rewards the teams. Another important challenge confronting business in India today is ethics. An ethically sound business environment is critical for us to be competitive in the global environment. I don't know how many of you would have read in the recent issue of the Economist magazine, where they talk about failures of Indian companies who have acquired businesses overseas. And there have been a lot of failures which may not have appeared in our press. One of the reasons the magazine gives for our failure is that they believe that a large number of these companies have grown in a culture of crony capitalism. And when these companies go abroad and do not have the right contacts, they cannot replicate domestic success. Recently, I met a very senior Indian professor. He still carries an Indian passport. At a well-known US university who was interested in distance education. I asked him what subject he would like to take up if he did this with Indian universities, and right off the top, his answer was ethics. I think we seriously need to think about this when the rest of the world has an opinion of this kind about our country. The ongoing discussions on the protection of intellectual property are also a case in point. If we as a society are unable to protect this vital asset, we might as well annihilate the very DNA of the innovation. Individuals and organizations will stop innovating. This will turn out to be a source of frustration for our talented teams who will not hesitate to migrate to places where intellectual property is protected and rewarded. The entire country will suffer for the short-sighted gains of a few. We have to unite to fight this malaise. With growing opportunities and aspirations, employees tend to move from one organization to another, often taking vital information with them. Many a times they're rewarded by their new employers for sharing this information. I think they need to realize that the same employees can be a source of nuisance when he or she leaves this new organization. Such practices also should be discouraged. I know in the West there are very strict contracts about protecting intellectual property, and we need to see what we can do as quickly as possible about it. Because otherwise, we are not going to create a better future for our coming generations. In KBL, we have made fairness in dealing with our stakeholders one of our core values. To us, fair means being objective in our dealings, It means transparency in business, and it means win-win situations. These values create successful and long-lasting businesses and partnerships. Many of the things I have spoken about are embedded in our value system, and we have made sure that we communicate this to our entire team. In fact, some of the youngsters in our organization, we encourage them to create what we call a code of ethics, which communicates various aspects of business ethics. And we followed that up by giving each employee a copy of that and getting their signature on that copy so that they are also committed to following this code. Business ethics are a source of competitive advantage for countries who embrace defined values and principles. Therefore, business ethics support sustainability as well as improve wealth of society. They can be a source of competitive advantage for companies as well. People, companies, and economies are required to think differently and out of the box in these changing times. While the government needs to come up with policies and reforms which increase the thrust on innovation and sustainability, businesses need to invest in both. As innovation is a central issue in economic prosperity, sustainable business practices are the central issue for human existence. While sustainability ensures continuity, innovation accelerates and compounds, and ethical business practices provide breeding ground for innovation. Sustainability, innovation, and ethics will continue to be the vital pillars of success of the human race for years to come. And now, I'd like to thank you for listening to me patiently. I think this has been one of the longest speeches I've given. And I'm going to be asked questions after this, so I hope I can answer. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Houses who desire to have a faster growth as compared to others and want to follow a path which we consider or some of us consider as not ethical. Is there a possibility that when a force like Anna Hazare has come in the country, the corporate houses combined together through their associations give their might and support to such kind of movement and ensure that these movements sustain themselves and get heard of? Is it possible that it can become a reality? Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your question. I think, like charity, ethics begins with oneself at home. And it is up to each one of us, more than trying to see who else is going to join us, to set the tone. It's going to be painful, I can assure you that once in such an environment, if you decide that you're not going to do things the kind that you mentioned to get ahead, it may be painful, you may not get the orders that you want, you may not grow as fast as you want, but I'd like to say that you'll probably sleep very well. Because when I see what has happened, and I don't want to get into names of any kind, but there have been companies that have grown fast and they have also fallen fast. And when more and more of us start believing in certain concepts, and you know, we may not be able to get together, but we will be able to find one another, companies who behave in the same way. And I think that would be a better force than asking
industry associations come together. Because industry associations are composed of all of us. And some of us may not want to go in a certain way. So for me, I think it's more what I would like my company to do and go that route and hope that others will follow. I hope I've answered you. Because it's very individualistic, I think.
I'm sure, but industry leaders like you will have to lead in order to create a movement which people like Anna Hazare would be able to move forward as a young new India. But thank you very much for this answer, and we hope it can go forward. Sir, my second question would be that, you know, when we talk of green corporates and reducing the carbon footprint, etc., is it possible that the associations like CII and others can play a much more major role in trying to bring about this awareness amongst their members and do it faster than what is happening today? Thank you.
Thank you. I'm glad you mentioned CII because I happen to head the Water Management Council. There is the CII Swaraj Godrej Green Business Center, and they're trying to see how you know, they can reduce the carbon footprint. They were in fact the first ones to put up the green platinum-rated green building in India, with U.S. aid and President Internet come to inaugurate it. But they conduct a lot of courses all the time on green sustainability, and all their members can take benefit of that. They also have CII Code on Sustainability, and quite a large number of companies have signed up for that. And it means that every year you commit to reducing usage of natural resources or electricity or water by a certain percentage, minimum percentage every year. And I'm sure CII keeps track of that. We've signed that code, and we found that, you know, it's very easy to do it in the first few years. It gets more and more difficult, but if you are innovative, you can ensure that every year you stay ahead of the game. The way we as a group do it is within our group, we have different committees, and we also have a sustainability committee. We have an energy conservation committee. And these are more factory-based than company-based. And we also have competitions between our factories. So there's a lot of new ideas that come in every year. And after we announce the winners, we share with every single participant what every company has done or what every factory has done. And this has helped us, you know, keep up to that code that is there. I'm sorry, I only know about the CII code. I'm sure TP also has something similar, and ISO China as well. We had huge questions about some of our own practices. And what we did was, and I'm being very open with you, and I hope you mind that. What we decided was, you know, we wanted to work in a certain way. And the young are very idealistic, right? And yes, that is why, when they come in, and that is why we said that, you know, let's get a group of young people who seem to be very interested growing along with this company to come up with a code for the whole company. And these were people who were in their late 20s and early 30s who, you know, in the normal course of things, you would call it to be company leaders or whatever. But they came out with something which we thought was good. Some of the people felt that, you know, this is not going to work. We tried our best to live up to that. We have, in addition to this, we also have a whistleblower policy in the company to ensure that if anyone feels that something is not going as per the code of ethics, it can be brought up right to our board level. And I'm lucky in the sense that I have a very active and interested board who wants to know what is happening. So after we had two policies that came out at the same time. One was a policy on this whistleblower policy, and the other one was for sexual harassment of employees. Both of these have been recommended by industry associations and also for corporate governments. I think you need to have these. I think the younger lot is quite happy. It's the senior or the middle management and above that's a little upset that the growth is not, that we can't, we walk away from orders or we don't take orders because for a reason or the other. And they say, how will this company grow if you're not doing this? So yeah, we have lost people. But in the larger scheme of things, what has also happened is we are all in a much better situation.
What would you feel, that generally the placement officers feel that companies that have a reputation for ethics, like yours or Tata's or some other names, they usually are not the preferred destinations of the youngsters? And what can the, say, teaching environment or training environment do to reverse that situation?
I think that's too much of a generalization. I don't think our young are like that.
No, because I interact with placement officers often, and I come across their preferred choices and all that.
I have not heard this from my HR head there. So it's not as if what to join because you don't do this or do that. Or
thank you so much.
But I don't know, maybe it's cultural, maybe it's, currently a company like us, and I'm sure there's a lot of companies over here also, we are perceived as threats by the large multinationals. When you grow beyond a certain size, you dominate an interesting market, then no one wants to work with you. And it's been quite an effort, actually, for some of us senior people, that even our high mission project that we started in the world. The idea about the product, our product, our business product, come out with a totally new product. And when people are, they are creators in a way. Just doing things differently, I think. Maybe it's also part of it is that we never respected intellectual property. I know so many people who copy our engines, our pumps, and there's very little you can do in it. So it's probably culture, it's probably not only our own culture as a nation, our business culture, and the fact that we are quite happy. At least that's my answer.
Now may I request Mr. Sanjay Mittal, President Volvo Aisha Commercial Vehicles, Mr. Rajesh Mittal, President Volvo Aisha Commercial Vehicle, to please present a token of thanks to our esteemed guest for today.
Our invitation and sharing thoughts on innovation, sustainability and ethics in the corporate world. Sir, it was a pleasure having you amongst us. I'm sure it provided much food for thought for all of us present here, and we have something great to take to our workplaces tomorrow. We are all very inspired by your great words. I'd also like to thank Mr. G.M. Amishwari, Director IMA, for his support. I express our gratitude to the Devas team of Kirloskar Brothers Limited for their support and coordination.
We are also grateful to Hotel Radisson Blu for their arrangements and hospitality. I also wish to express my sincere thanks to the press for their support and coverage. Very importantly, I'd like to thank our wonderful audience for being a part of IMA celebration of 50th year and 22nd International Management Conclave 2013. As you know, that IMA completes 50 years in 2013, and we also mark today's day as the beginning of the Golden Jubilee celebration. We thank you for being with us this evening. It's been a great pleasure. Thank you. I now request all of you to please join us.